Can we please put our hands together and give a huge welcome to the Babar Bar stage for John Bostock.
Someday I will go to Aarhus to see his peak brown head, the mild pods of his eyelids, his pointed skin cap. There are probably some people in the audience that recognise these lines. Those that do will perhaps have an idea of what I'm going to be talking about tonight. These are the opening lines of a 1972 poem by Seamus Heaney, one of Ireland's greatest 20th century poets. The subject of the poem will soon become clear, but first of all, I'd like to take you back 40 years ago to the early 1980s when I was living and working in Denmark. Around about this time, two momentous things happened in my life. Firstly, I met my wife, who I'm happy to say is still with me. And I met a man who was born and died 400 years before the birth of Christ. That man is known as Tollund Man. I would like to introduce you to the man I met all those years ago. I made the acquaintance of Tollund Man in 1983, and in Seamus Heaney's words, I saw his peat brown head and his pointed skin cap. I also saw the serene look on his face, and I felt a kinship that is still with me today. We were on a summer vacation in Jutland in the west of Denmark when we visited Silkeborg Museum, and I saw for the first time this man from the Iron Age, who's been in my thoughts many times since that day 40 years ago. As you walk into the small room and up to the cabinet house in Tollund Man, you feel a frisson of excitement as you gaze in awe upon this man with a leather skull cap and stubble on his chin, lying in gentle repose. He has a face that seems vaguely familiar, and you almost expect him to suddenly open his eyes, smile, and inquire how long he had been asleep. That slide shows in great detail Tollund Man's 2,400-year-old stubble. When gazing at him, you're suddenly drawn to the rope around his neck, and with a shock you realise that this seemingly peaceful face belied his violent and traumatic death in the desolate fens of Jutland 2,400 years ago. But why on earth was this man executed in such a brutal fashion? This death and countless other violent deaths of both men and women found in the bogs of Denmark and beyond have been the subject of numerous theories over the years. Had they committed a terrible crime in their community, or had their behaviour merely transgressed the social rules and norms of this society? One theory which has continued to gain traction is that they were willing victims who were sacrificed to appease the ancient pagan gods and goddesses to ensure fertility and prosperity for the year ahead. I think it's about time we met the archaeologist. A few months after my first meeting with Tollund Man, I was chatting to a work colleague about my visit, and he introduced me to the definitive book on the subject, written in 1971, which not only covered the man from Tollund, but numerous other bodies that had been discovered in the peat bogs of Denmark and elsewhere in Northern Europe. It was called appropriately The Bog People and was written by Peter V. Globe, a renowned archaeologist and director of the Danish National Museum. My colleague lent me to the book, which I devoured, and when he left a few months later, I'm ashamed to say I forgot to return his dog-eared paperback. I have it still to this day. All the pages are starting to fall out and it's even more well-thumbed. I hope I'm forgiven, but I think it's probably time I bought my own copy. Anybody thinking that archaeology is a rather dry subject should read this book. It is part thriller, part detective story, part history lesson, and part philosophical treatise. In other words, a fascinating read, in part due to the subject matter, and in part due to the beautiful writing of the author. In the book, Professor Globe tells the stories of the bog people of Northern Europe in the Iron Age, their beliefs, how they lived, and speculation on how they died. Throughout the centuries, there have been dozens of bodies discovered in peat bogs throughout Scandinavia, the British Isles, and elsewhere. But somehow Denmark seems to have had its fair share of discoveries. The earliest finds have not survived, but from the 19th century, finds were better documented, and finally in the 20th century, many of these bodies were preserved for posterity. Perhaps at this stage, we should say a few words about the author, Professor Peter Wilhelm Globe. Peter Globe was not only an academic, he was also a man of action. From 1949 until 1961, Globe was Professor of Northern Archaeology and European Prehistory at Aarhus Museum. However, he did not confine himself to the lecture halls. He participated in many important expeditions to Greenland, as well as many archaeological digs in the Persian Gulf, where he made many significant finds. This was in addition to his everyday duties in the museum, where he was present at all the major archaeological finds in Jutland. I think these two photographs of Globe give a good impression of the man. In the first, he can be seen trudging across the Danish peat bogs with his equipment. In the second, on location in Bahrain, looking totally at ease with his Arab headgear. In both pictures, he has a pipe dangling from the corner of his mouth, very much the fashion of the time. To my mind, and I hope you agree, there's something of Indiana Jones about him, a man of action looking for adventure. But let's get back to the discovery of Tollund Man. In the first paragraph of the book, Globe poetically describes the day in 1950 when Tollund Man's 2,000-year sleep was brutally interrupted by two farmers digging for peat to keep them warm during the winter months. An early spring day, 8th of May 1950. Evening was gathering over Tollund Fen in Bjelsgård Dale. Momentarily, the sun burst in, bright and yet subdued, through a gate in blue thunderclouds in the west, bringing everything to life. The evening stillness was only broken now and again by the grating love call of the snipe. The dead man, too, deep in the umber brown peat, seemed to have come alive. He lay on his damp bed as though asleep, resting on his head, on his side, the head inclined a little forward, arms and legs bent. His face wore a gentle expression, the eyes lightly closed, the lips softly pursed, as if in silent prayer. It was as though the dead man's soul had for a moment returned from another world through the gate in the western sky. When they first uncovered the face, it seemed so fresh that they thought they had found a recent murder victim. However, once the police arrived, it became clear that this was definitely an ancient cold case, and Professor Globe was quickly summoned to supervise the excavation. Of the numerous bog bodies, Tollund Man was unique in that his face was intact and in perfect condition. In fact, it's the best preserved human head to have survived from antiquity in any part of the world. Unfortunately, as preservation techniques were not as advanced as nowadays, a decision was made to concentrate on the preservation of the head. As a result, the body was cut up into several parts and ended up scattered throughout various institutes and museums throughout Denmark. This slide shows Tollund Man as he looked shortly after he was excavated. And you can see he's got his knees drawn up, up to his stomach, and we'll talk about that later. Now it's time to move on to the crime scene. In this slide, you can see two maps. On the left-hand side is a map of Denmark, and for those who are not so familiar with Denmark, it is divided into three areas. There's Zealand, which is where the capital of Copenhagen is. There's Funen in the middle, and then in the west side, the larger area is Jutland, which borders Germany. It can be seen that Tollund Man and another bog body, Grobalerman, were found in the centre of Jutland near Silkeborg and Aarhus. On the right side, you can see a map of Northern Europe showing where the bog bodies have been found. Although there have been several discoveries in the UK and Ireland, most finds have been in Denmark, Northern Germany and Holland. So you can see there's a large amount of bog bodies down there. Some in England and Wales, but not quite so many, and a few in Ireland. Several other bog bodies have been found in the near vicinity of Silkeborg, such as Ellen Woman and Grobalerman, who can be seen on the left side of the photograph here. As you can see, he's not as good looking as Tollund Man, as his face has been somewhat flattened, possibly inadvertently, by one of the people recovering his body, but he does have a good head of hair. His hand, shown on the right-hand side of the frame, is exquisite, showing every detail of his hand, fingers and nails. It could almost be a sketch by Leonardo da Vinci. As we've seen from the maps above, the bog bodies were not just confined to the North Sea area of Holland, Germany and Denmark, although that is where most finds have originated. There have also been several discoveries in the UK, one of the most famous and more recent being Lindow Man, seen here found in a bog in Cheshire in 1984. The local community humorously christened him Pete Marsh. All these bodies have one thing in common. They have all met violent deaths through strangling or other gruesome methods. Some appear to have even been tortured. However, I keep returning to the man who started me on this voyage of discovery, Tollund Man, and to look more closely in the area where he was found. So here, as you can see in the picture here, this is Bielskog Dale, where Tollund Man was found. It's a wild and rather desolate area, part of an ancient landscape that has existed for thousands of years. It is a fitting area for the last resting place of our bog man. This place here is the actual spot where Tollund Man was found, and if you see a bit closer towards the top of the trunk, there's a commemoration plaque remembering the two labourers who found it when they were digging for peat. What is it about these peat bogs that allows bodies to be so well preserved? Unique conditions in peat bogs means that the bog bodies often retain their skin and internal organs, as well as hairs, nail, teeth, wool and leather. A combination of the acidity of the soil and a lack of oxygen preserve the skins, whereas the bones are dissolved by the acidity in the peat. The bodies are all a red-brown colour as a result of the tannins in the soil. There are also large amounts of sphagnum moss in the bogs, which aid the preservation process. And you can see here, you can see where there's an area with a lot of sphagnum moss, and that's typical of a peat bog. Now it's time to get on to the motive. The question everyone keeps asking is how and why did these people die? Most people during pre-Christian times in Northern Europe were cremated on pyres, so there was obviously a particular reason why the bodies in the bogs were buried in a ritualized way. They were killed in a variety of ways, either bludgeoned, strangled, hanged, such as Tollund Man, stabbed, or a combination of all of them. They were also laid in the earth in a special manner on their side with their legs up, drawn up to their stomach, as you may recall in the previous slide that I showed you. Globe argued very persuasively that these were sacrifices to the gods, and he uses as evidence the many artifacts found in the peat bogs, which show a deep allegiance to the Nordic pagan fertility gods, including the goddesses Freya and Nertus. In a bog north of Silkeborg, not far from the Tollund Man, one of the most famous Iron Age artifacts was discovered, the wonderful Gunnestrup cauldron, which you can see in this picture here. This magnificent gilded silver vessel, probably originating in the Balkans, is covered in various symbols, mythical animals, and representations of gods and goddesses. And more importantly, a scene showing a human sacrifice. It does not take a great leap of imagination to connect the scene on the side of the vessel to our Tollund Man a few miles further away. And here you can see on the side of the cauldron is the sacrifice which is shown. And then also there's a statue here of the fertility goddess Freya, which was found in a bog not far from Tollund Man, which was wrapped in cloth and dug up from the peat. Since Globe's time, other theories have arisen that bog people were social outcasts, witches, or enemy hostages killed over broken treaty arrangements. Although many archaeologists still believe that the most likely explanation is still that of human sacrifice. Whether these poor souls were willing victims is altogether another question, one which is impossible to answer. However, looking at the peaceful face of Tollund Man, I have the feeling that he had resigned himself to be sacrificed for the greater good. Now it's time to move on to the case of the missing toe. There's a strange postscript to this story. I shouldn't go back on that. There's a strange postscript to this story. This is the case. If you remember earlier, I stated the body had been scattered throughout Denmark without much thought, an act of unforgivable carelessness. In the 1980s, a new museums director at Silkeborg Museum started to look for the Tollund Man's body. After a great deal of searching, they located the body parts, enabling the meticulous reconstruction of the body. At last, Tollund Man's head was reunited to his body, and he was whole again, for the first time since he was lifted from the ground in 1950. But not quite. There was a toe missing, sawn off at some stage in the proceedings. There were many rumours about what had happened to the toe, but it was not until 2016 that the truth emerged when the daughter of one of the original conservators rang the museum and informed them that the missing toe was in her possession. It was not until her parents were dead that she had plucked up courage to own up and return the toe to its true home. The story was that her father had taken the toe home to experiment with various preservation techniques, or maybe, if truth be told, he just wanted a souvenir. Apparently, it was a well-known rumour in the area, and when the daughter told her school classmates that she had Tollund Man's toe and no one believed her, and why would you, she brought it into class next day in her pocket to the delight and horror of her classmates. It's amazing that it survived, but here it is, the toe, which is kept in a little child's basket, and you can see here, when it was reunited with the foot, it was a perfect fit. We should finally move on to the poem. Of course, I'm not the only person to be drawn into the web of the Bog People and the Tollund Man. The greatest Irish poet of his generation and Nobel Prize winner, Seamus Heaney, became obsessed after reading Peter Globe's book. And in his 1972 collection, Wintering Out, he wrote one of his most famous poems, The Tollund Man. In his 1975 collection, North, Heaney's meditation on the troubles in Northern Ireland, he wrote many more bog poems, including The Bog Queen, Grauballer Man, Punishment, amongst others, where he uses the bog bodies as a metaphor for the violence, punishment, and terrible sacrifices being made in his home country. At the time of its composition, Heaney had not been to Denmark, and his poem was solely inspired by Globe's book. He remedied this several years later by visiting the museum and meeting Globe in person, and he made a number of subsequent trips to Denmark. We have no record of their conversation together, but it would have been fascinating to have been a fly on the wall when the great poet met the renowned archaeologist. In 1979, Heaney explained movingly what had drawn him to the Tollund Man and why it resonated with him so strongly. The Tollund Man seemed to me like an ancestor almost, one of my old uncles, one of those moustached archaic faces you used to meet all over the Irish countryside. I felt very close to this and the sacrificial element, the territorial religious element, the whole mythological field surrounding these images was very potent. So I tried, not explicitly, to make a connection between the sacrificial, ritual, religious element in the violence of contemporary Ireland and this terrible sacrificial religious thing in the Bog People. After all this time, Tollund Man still fires my imagination. Was he a willing sacrifice? An enemy combatant put to death, or just a common criminal paying for his sins? We shall never know, but perhaps this is irrelevant, for in some strange way he has gained immortality, lying in his glass case, as he will surely outlive us all. But I think we should leave the last word to Seamus Heaney. Poetry is at its best when read aloud, and this poem is even more moving and affecting when spoken by the author himself in his soft, lilting Irish accent. So here is Tollund Man, read by Seamus Heaney.
The Tollund Man. Someday I will go to Aarhus to see his peat brown head, the mild pods of his eyelids, his pointed skin cap. In the flat country nearby where they dug him out, his last gruel of winter seeds caked in his stomach, naked except for the cap, noose and girdle, I will stand a long time. Bridegroom to the goddess, she tightened her torque on him and opened her fen. Those dark juices working him to a saint's kept body, trove of the turf cutter's honeycombed workings. Now his stained face reposes at Aarhus. I could risk blasphemy, consecrate the cauldron bog, our holy ground, and pray him to make germinate the scattered, ambushed flesh of labourers, stocking corpses laid out in the farmyards, telltale skin and teeth flecking the sleepers of four young brothers trailed for miles along the lines. Something of his sad freedom as he rode the tumbril should come to me, driving, saying the names Tollund, Graubal, Nabelgord, watching the pointing hands of country people, not knowing their tongue. Out there in Jutland, in the old man-killing parishes, I will feel lost, unhappy, and at home.
Thank you.
Fantastic. What a great first bravado, 2023. Thank you so much, John. That was brilliant.